That's right, Leanne, we are most honored in our studio today to have as a special guest international best-selling author who's brought us books like The Pact, My Sister's Keeper, and Sing You Home. And it's great to have her in the motherland talking about her latest offering, which is called Lone Wolf. Jodi Picoult is right here in our studio. Good morning, Jodi.
Good morning.
Oh, it's such an honor to have you with us here. And thank welcome you. To the mother. I don't know if anybody's officially welcomed you to South Africa, but officially welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
You've been here for about just over almost a week now, right?
Right? Yep.
What's your stay been like in South Africa?
It's been great. I love meeting my fans in South Africa. They are among the most rabid fans that I have in the world. They read everything that I write. And honestly, who wouldn't want to come to a country for
indeed,
that?
Indeed, indeed. And you say they do read you a lot. I mean, having published 20 books that have been translated into 40 different languages, I think it's safe to say your career has been very successful.
Well, thank you. Yes, I've been lucky.
To what do you attribute that success?
Well, I think a lot of it is hard work. People underestimate the amount of work that goes into writing. They think you're waiting for the inspiration. And in reality, I work a work day just like you do. You know, I get up in the morning, I go to my office, I sit there, and then I go downstairs at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot more perspiration to writing than there is inspiration.
I can imagine. And I want to talk a bit about that writing process. When you say it's a 9-to-5 like everyone works, in that time you write. How does it work in your everyday life? Do you know, you go out for breakfast, get your coffee, and while you're sipping on your coffee, something happens in your head and then you rush to write it. How does it work?
Usually the things that make me write happen at night. I don't know why, but they wake me up. So very often the things that I'm thinking about right before I go to bed, the things that worry me as a wife, as an American, as a mother, they stick in my head and I keep worrying over them and worrying over them. And eventually, if I keep thinking about that, it's a very good idea for a book.
Wow. You say things that keep you up at night that worry you. One of your books, 19 Minutes.
Yes.
Written one of your very first bestsellers, I think, about a shooting in a school in a town in the States. When you look at that book and you look at what's happening in the States right now, how do you find the link and how do you see that maybe, let's say, a book like that, reading a book like that, could possibly help the situation?
Well, it's very gratifying to have something like the Newtown shootings happen and then to have fans write you to say, I couldn't make sense of this, so I picked up your book again and I reread it, and that really helped. You know, the thing about school shootings is that I could have told you there would be another one, and there probably will be yet another one in the United States. Mm. They will continue to happen, unfortunately, until we begin to do a little bit of reform, not just gun reform, which I'm very happy to hear President Obama is starting, but also mental health services being more available to parents and kids, which are not very well covered right now by our health insurance, and most importantly, the role of the media, which people very much overlook and which I cover in 19 Minutes. Mm-hmm. When we see these shootings happen, very often we see the media glorifying the shooter. They talk about, what did he do? Did he leave a manifesto? Here's a picture of him with his ammunition.
He's almost hyped up as some kind of celebrity.
And so some kid who's 10, 11, 12 years old and is feeling a little marginalized is going to remember that. And 5 years from now, when he's thinking, I don't want to be on this planet anymore, I want to check out, he might think, well, you know, you may not know my name now, but I know a way for you to remember my name because I saw it on the news. I would love for the media in America to adopt the same policy that they have with rape victims, which is to not identify a rape victim. It would be really nice if they never named the shooter.
Yeah.
Because that takes away some of the notoriety.
Exactly.
Yeah.
All right. Now, your books are filled with a message, a deeper message that I think tries to speak to people and tries to teach something very important about life. I mean, My Sister's Keeper. I have never in my life cried in a movie as I did watching My Sister's
Keeper. I cried too, but for a different reason, because they changed the ending of the book.
Yeah. Tell us about that. So what did you make of it when you saw the movie and they changed it into, you know?
Well, I knew in advance. When you give a book up for film, it's like giving a baby up for adoption. You are not allowed to call every day and say, did you feed her breakfast? You just hope for the best. And I actually had been asked to interview Nick Cassavetes, who is the director, very talented man, very good writer, excellent director, before they hired him. One of the things I said was, it's really important to me that the ending stayed the same because it's a big twist and it's sold millions of books around the world. He read the book, he said, you are right, that is the only ending for this story, I'm not going to change it. If anyone does, I'm going to tell you why, and I'm going to tell you myself.
Okay.
And I thought, that's fair. He spent a year calling me up, asking me for help as he was writing the script, and asking for character descriptions, and very much involving me. And he wrote a script that looked a lot like the book. And then one day, I got an email from a fan who worked at a casting agency. And she said, did you know they changed the ending? We have the script.
Oh, my goodness.
So I called Nick at home. He wouldn't take my call. I went to the movie set, and he threw me off the movie set. And I went to the head of New Line Cinema, Warner Brothers Studios, and I said, you're going to lose money on this. And he said, no, 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 we know what we're doing. And they lost money on that. So now I'm a little bit of a psychic in Hollywood.
So are you now a bit more apprehensive towards giving your books out to be made into, let's say, feature films?
Well, no, because of many reasons. When you give your book up for film, it's not because you expect to see such an accurate representation on the screen. It's because there are so many more people who see movies than read books. And ultimately, my job is not to make movies, it's to get people to read my books. And I can tell you that even with a book like My Sister's Keeper going to film, I have thousands of emails from people who said, you know, after I saw the movie, I heard it was a book and I read the book and it's so much better, and now I've read everything that you've ever written.
Exactly.
Which is
fantastic.
What you want.
Absolutely. Well, it's great to have you here with us. We're
Thank
looking
you.
Forward to chatting
Thank
to you,
so
you a
much.
Bit more. But I'm going to ask you a big favor, because
sure.
you have a whole set of books here that you need to sign, because we've promised everyone at home that they're going to be winning a book set, or six
Fantastic.
Of them.
Fantastic.
Six of them, especially signed by you, so you're going to have to get through all of these, and of course...
I can do it.
If you want to stand a chance to win a specially signed copy of a book set by Jodi Picoult, you'll be winning three books in each set. All you got to do is SMS the keyword, which is win your name and city to 33728. But stay tuned, lots more to come with Jodi Picoult.